The last time I spoke was probably, what, 3 or 4 weeks ago? And I asked the question, does anyone know from the Bible who Onesimus was? Right? I asked that question. You remember that? Well, our memory text, our scripture reading this morning, is from that same section of scripture. And I just want to put up on the screen, here's my title this morning, Are We Trusting in God? And here's the scripture reading that Ed read for us. Thank you, Ed. Now, this man's name, if you want to turn there to Luke chapter 24, I just want to give a little background to this before we get started. Luke chapter 24 is where this text comes from. And Cleopas, that's the name, Cleopas. I don't know why I mispronounced that name, Cleopas. I'd never thought much about this Cleopas. He was one of Jesus' disciples, not one of the 12. But this account on the road to Emmaus, where Jesus was walking with these two disciples, unknown to them that it was Jesus, the resurrected Jesus that was with them. And this is what Jesus said to them on the screen. O fools and slow of heart to believe that all the prophets have spoken. What position are we in today? Are we in a position personally, with our friends, with our loved ones, on a day-to-day basis, to keep trusting in God, placing our trust in what He said in His Word? About a week and a half ago, Mark and I had a conversation about what the next few sermons might be here at Prophecies of Hope. There's a lot going on in our world. We had an election. There's a lot of people disappointed with the results of that election. A lot of people that are thrilled with the results of that election. So, you know, as we thought about those things, we wanted to point people away from what's happening in the world and back to God's Word. And I hope you can agree with my next statement. No matter who was elected or is elected president of the United States, God's Word is sure. It's sure. The prophecies in this book are going to come to pass, no matter who is the president of the United States or any other country in this world. That's amazing, isn't it? You turn on the news, you turn on the radio, you turn on the internet, you use your phone, you see it on TV. What can you believe today, and what in what are you putting your trust? Well, I'm happy to say when you walk through the doors of Prophecies of Hope, or when you turn your computer on to watch Prophecies of Hope, we're going to be pointing to you back to the prophecies of God, back to the sure word of Scripture, because there's nothing else in this world that we can put our trust in. So I want to direct you back to what I have on the screen one more time. I can look at myself and ask, am I slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken about Christ Jesus, about the world to come, what's happening now in our time? Am I slow of heart? Am I a fool in that way? And I'm going to ask you to look at yourself and your own life and ask the same question today. Let's move along to Acts chapter 1. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles quite a bit today. Acts chapter 1, and I'm going to use some Bible examples that kind of, they can be disturbing in some ways when we look at them, and they can be uplifting in many ways if we look at them from a particular point of view. Acts chapter 1, And I'm just going to start reading in verse 1, and we're going to see what we're going to see. Let me give it some background, though. Acts chapter 1. So Acts chapter 1 starts out at the point of time where Jesus Christ has been resurrected. He's been resurrected, and he's with his disciples. And here's what we find. The former treaty I have made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach, until the day in the which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For truly John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. So we get the picture of what's happening. Jesus is with his disciples for a full 40 days after his resurrection. And before Pentecost, he was there. Now look at verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Don't you find this a little odd? Here were the disciples that had spent 3.5 years with Jesus. They've experienced the deep lows of his capture by night, of a trial by night, of his crucifixion. There was no hope left, and yet they came to the tomb and found it empty. And Jesus was risen. And here, after all that, they didn't understand that his kingdom was not of this world. Don't you find that amazing? Thank you, Haley, for nodding your head. I find it truly amazing. What am I missing? How am I not putting my trust in God, in his word? How am I being sidetracked in this life? What did the disciples miss? What didn't they understand at this particular time? I want to keep moving along. There's plenty in Scripture that demonstrates the fact that we as human beings, we want to follow our own path. We want to put our trust in the things that we can see and feel, and in that ballot that we place in the machine, we want to put our trust in those things rather than our trust in God. Let's turn to Numbers chapter 13. It's all through Scripture. It's all through Scripture. Numbers chapter 13. Now, I'm hoping, look, there. I can't explain everything from Scripture in one short sermon. So I'm hoping you have an understanding of this particular account from Numbers chapter 13 and into 14. Let me give you some background, though. God, through Moses and Aaron, had led the children of Israel out of Egypt. Think about it. Maybe 1 million people walked on dry land through the Red Sea. And day by day, they're being fed by the hand of God. Manna. Their clothes are not wearing out. They've traveled a long way through the wilderness. But pretty soon after they left Egypt and after they left Mount Sinai, God led them to the edge of the Promised Land. And here's the account in Numbers chapter 13. I'm going to start reading in verse 1, and I'm going to skip down a few places because There are a lot of names that I don't want to try to pronounce and everything like that, but we'll get the idea of what God is trying to reveal in his word. Numbers chapter 13. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, send thou men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall you send a man, every one a ruler among them. And Moses, by the commandment of the Lord, sent them from the wilderness of Paran, all those men who were heads of the children of Israel. And here it lists those people. Down in verse 16, let's pick it back up. It says, and these are the names of the men which Moses sent to spy out the land. That sounds exciting, doesn't it? I was picked to be a spy. Verse 16, it's to spy out the land. And Moses called Oshea, the son of Nun, Joshua. And Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said unto them, get you up this way southward and go up into the mountain and see the land, what it is, and the people that dwelleth therein, whether they be strong or weak, few or many, and what the land is that they dwell in, whether it be good or bad, and what cities they be that they dwell in, whether in tents or in strongholds, and what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, or whether it be wood therein or not, and be ye of good courage, and bring of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. Verse 21. So they went up and searched the land for the wilderness of Zin to Rehob, as men come to Hamath. It does sound exciting, doesn't it? I'm sure they had to be careful. Let's skip down to verse 26. And they went and came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran and Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told them and said, we came into a land whither thou sentest us, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Nevertheless, the people are strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. Amen. Verse 31. But the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land, which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it, it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, so we were in their sight. Now, wait a minute. This is the land that God suggested they might have part of, right? This is the land that he kind of suggested to Abraham that he was going to give to his descendants. And to Isaac and Jacob, those were just suggestions, right? No. No, this is the promised land. This is the promised land. So who are they going to put their trust in? Are they going to put their trust in their spears and their bows? Or are they going to trust God? On to chapter 14. And all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night. And all the children of Israel murmured against Moses, Aaron, and the whole congregation said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God that we had died in this wilderness? And wherefore hath the Lord brought us into this land, to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be prey? Were it not better for us to return to Egypt? They said one to another, let us make a captain and let us return into Egypt. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, they rent their clothes. And they spoke unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we pass through to search it, it's an exceedingly good land. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. The rest of the story is this, that because of that decision, they spent 40 more years in the wilderness. And not one of those people that murmured against God and against his servants made it into the promised land. And still God fulfilled his promise. He still fulfilled his promise. And those that put their trust in him, namely Caleb and Joshua, went into the land. As you can see, trust in God, or your lack of it, is all through the scripture. It wasn't difficult to find this week, preparing for this message. But how do we put that in practical application for our own lives? Do we look around at all the things happening in the world and do we get discouraged in those things? I mentioned the election. Do we get so discouraged that we take our focus off putting our trust in God, putting him first in everything that we do, trusting his guidance and direction and his promises, the truth of his word? It's a daily struggle. I have another example from Scripture. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 37. And Pamela, I'm thankful that you mentioned this Wednesday night, because I'd already written notes down by Wednesday night for my sermon. When you mentioned this, it's like, again, God is bringing us together to think about things from his word, the truth of his word. Genesis chapter 37. Again, if you don't know the story of Joseph, I encourage you to read the accounts of Joseph in the scripture. They are beautiful. And it just goes to show us that when we put our trust in God, it doesn't matter what happens. We're going to be okay. Genesis chapter 37, and I'm going to start reading in verse 1. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. And these are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Uh-oh. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children. That's Jacob, remember. Because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. That doesn't sound like the fruits of the Spirit that we read about in Sabbath school, does it? Verse 5, and Joseph dreamed a dream. And he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood around about my sheaf and made obeisance, or worshipped my sheaf. And his brethren said unto him, shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars made obeisance or worship to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? But look at verse 11. It says, His brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. Now remember, we're talking about Jacob. We're talking about Jacob. Jacob's been through an awful lot in his life. He's learned an awful lot through his years. Jacob observed the saying. I looked this word observed up in quite a few different translations. Mary, what does your Bible say? Kept the matter in mind. He kept the matter in mind. Let me ask you. It's difficult sometimes to know how to trust God. But our experience over time, the faith that we have put in God in the past, and His faithfulness to us, builds our faith for the future. That's what I see here in Jacob. And we have choices to make, like Jacob and his sons. We can ask God how to put our trust in Him. We can use the things that have happened in our past to put our trust in God for the future. Who are we going to be like? Are we going to be like Jacob, where our ears are tuned to what God is trying to tell us, or like Joseph's brothers, who didn't put any stock in these dreams? Well, you know how the story completes itself. Joseph was sold into slavery. But he was sold into slavery for a purpose. That when God sent a famine on the land, he would be in charge of all of Egypt. And when his brothers and his family needed him the most, indeed they had to bow down to him. The dreams came true. What will we put our trust in? You know, it's always been an interesting thought to me that when Jesus' disciples, his closest disciples, asked him about the future, asked him about what was going to happen in the future, the first thing out of his mouth I think is very important. And I'm going to show those texts to you today. In Matthew chapter 24, here's what it says. As he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And here's his response. Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. And I want to move on to another gospel. It's the same account. And as he sat on the Mount of Olives, this is from Mark chapter 13, over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus, answering them, began to say, Take heed lest any man deceive you. Really, when you think about his response, it's about who are we going to put our trust in? Are we going to put our trust in our fellow men? In a preacher or a pastor or a presidential candidate? Are we going to put our trust in God? What's interesting about these two accounts, both Mark and Matthew, tell us the same thing. I'm a little distracted because I want to get to this next part, but there's no good segue because I'm going to come back to this about take heed that no man deceive you. And I'm going to give a good example of something that just needles me. It really gets to me when people put on social media something like this. Now, this is a Bible text, okay? This is a wonderful text. And we take a look at this text, we can all read it. It says, "I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him." This is wonderful. But it's taken out of context. Almost every single time. And you know, this is one of those things that when you see it, when you're shown this, you're going to say, "Oh, you should have shown that to me. I can't unsee that. I can't take it back." So we need to go and read about this text in context. And it's going to demonstrate how we can put our trust in even Bible texts that people show us. If they're taken out of context, they don't do us much good. But if we put our trust in the whole of God's Word, what He has to say. So the text is right there. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And we're going to read this text in context. And for those of you who haven't read it in context, I think it's going to be a little shocking. Remember, eye has not seen nor ear heard what God has in store for them that love him, right? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, let me find it. Chapter 2, and I'm just going to begin right at the beginning of the chapter so that we can see the context of all of it. Remember, let's not be deceived, even by somebody posting a text on social media. And believe it or not, this, I want to show you, I want to go back. This, I saw this week, one of my friends on social media posted this. And so it's real. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. "And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power." Amen to that, right? "That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Remember, trusting in God. Verse 6, "Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." It's pretty simple, right? If those people which put Christ Jesus to death had known the gospel and who Christ Jesus was, they wouldn't even have thought about putting him to death. Amen. And here's our text. "But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the thing which God hath prepared for them that love him." Right? No, let's keep reading. "Which God hath prepared for them that love him, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God." If we're listening, if we're trusting in God, we know the things that God has prepared for us, because they've been revealed to us if we just read and pray listen. Are we trusting in God? I'm going to go back to the Gospels. And I want to take in the same account here several times in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, like we did the other time. Here it says in Matthew 20, "And Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and they shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge, and to crucify him, and the third day he shall rise again." Told this to the disciples before it ever happened. And it's not just once in Scripture. That was Matthew, this is Mark. "And they departed hence and passed through Galilee, and he would not that any man should know it, for he taught the disciples and said unto them, The Son of Man is delivered unto the hands of men, and they shall kill him. And after that he is killed, he shall rise the third day." And just to make it complete, if I can get the clicker to work, same thing in Luke. "And he straitly charged them and commanded them to tell no man that thing, saying, The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be slain and be raised the third day." So why did they forget that? I'm asking myself, the things I've read in Scripture, the things I know, what do I need to change about that so that God can truly give me the truth of His Word, not just the things that I think I know about Scripture? Put my complete trust in God, not trust in my upbringing or what teachers have taught me about what the Word of God says. My complete trust in God. I didn't put these texts in, but I want to turn to these texts because they're really interesting. I want you to turn to knowing what we know about Jesus, that he's going to be killed and he's going to be raised up by his Father the third day. Knowing what we know, let's turn to Matthew chapter 27. And I want to point something out that's really striking to me. Matthew chapter 27 and verses, I'm going to read starting in, let me just give you some background. This is the crucifixion. This is the crucifixion as recorded by Matthew. And I'm going to start in verse 55. Matthew 27, verse 55. "And many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him. Among which were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. And when evening was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciples. And he went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled the great stone to the door of the sepulcher and departed. And there was Mary Magdalene, the other Mary, sitting over against the sepulcher. Now the next day that followed, the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, and they said," in verse 63, "Sir, we remember who came," Verse 62, it says, "Now the next day that follows the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, and they said," in verse 63, "Sir, we remember that the deceiver," they're talking about Jesus, "said while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again." Now wait a minute. The evil men of the day remembered Jesus' words and the disciples didn't? That's what this says. Verse 64, command there, therefore, that the sepulcher be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, he has risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. You understand what's happening? The evil men of the day remembered Jesus' words. Turn over to Luke chapter 24 with me. And I'm going to start reading in verse 1. Now upon the first, Luke chapter 24, verse 1. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. Amen to that. Verse 4, and it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments, and as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. You mean to tell me that the evil men of the day could recite Jesus' words and knew what they were, but the so-called saints had to be reminded? So I'm asking you, as I'm asking myself, what do I need to be reminded of? Should I have to be reminded? Should I just go ahead and put my trust in God and what he says? Remember our scripture reading this morning. O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. We don't have anything to worry about in this world. We truly don't. If we put our trust in Almighty God, the creator of the universe, we don't have anything to worry about. Here are Jesus' words. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Friends, we can put our faith and trust in what the Word of God says. We need to trust that first and put the kingdom of God first.